Доброе утро. Did I do that okay? Okay, that's good. Welcome to this event. I want to thank first the Skolkovo Foundation for partnering with us on this event, and I tell you that for the New York Academy of Sciences, we're delighted to be doing really the first event we've ever done in Russia, and I hope it's the first of many. And I'll come back and tell you about one that we'll be doing next year as an example. But first, as the president and the CEO of the Academy, I thought that it would be interesting for you to hear a little bit about what makes our Academy unusual, because it relates to this particular meeting. We're the only Academy in the world that's open to anybody who wants to be a member. And this was intentional. When we were founded in 1817, there were six or seven doctors at the first medical school of New York who thought there should be a place where people could come together and talk about science from different fields who never met each other, and even to have young people come. And they wanted to create a kind of a club. And they went to Boston and Philadelphia, which were the only places that had older organizations. And they found that the academies there were like your academies, where you had to be famous and elected to be a member. And that meant that they were old people. And they didn't like the idea of old white men being the only members of the academy. So from the beginning, they encouraged people who sometimes weren't scientists. I know in this room there are economists. And one of the things we're proud of at our academy is that we have not only the greatest scientists in the world, we have, for example, 27 Nobel Prize winners just on my president's council. And members, maybe there's 40 or 50, I don't even count them. But we have business people that are interested in science, too. Even in the beginning, we had the President Jefferson, Thomas Jefferson of the United States, was a member, and governors of New York State were members. And we had Europeans in the very first year. 10 Europeans joined from Netherlands, from Sweden, from the UK, and from Germany. So we became the only global academy. And today, as you would see in your little program, we have 25,000 members in 140 countries. And we have 8,000 plus student members, which isn't as many as your Young Scientists Network that are partners. I think they have 15,000, I heard yesterday. But 8,000 is pretty good for an academy. So we're very devoted to young people. And that's really important for you to know. And in fact, this event is a wonderful thing in a different way, because it takes me back to one of the first things I did when I came to the Academy to be the leader. It's almost 10 years ago. If you look at my little bio, you'll see I was the editor of Science Magazine. And when I came to the Academy, it was because a Nobel Prize winner, who was the chairman, said I had to come and wake it up because it was falling asleep. And the first thing I discovered were there were only 200 student members. And I thought, this is not going to be the future, it's going to be the past. So what we created immediately was the Science Alliance for graduate students, what you'd call postgraduate students and postdocs. And what it does and did is exactly what's happening here. So when I came from science, I had, in Science Magazine, created the first website for young scientists to give career advice. And we had countries, entire countries, Netherlands, Germany, Singapore, China, that were Canada, that were members, just to get advice to their young scientists. Why? Because every country has the same problem you do, which is the professors, by and large, don't want to take the time to actually give you career advice. In fact, many of them would like you to just be their little slaves and stay in the laboratory and do what they want. And if they're nice and they would like to give you career advice, many times they actually don't know what the new things are that are happening, because they've been sitting in their own labs for too long and they don't know what's going on in the world. So when I came to New York and I thought, okay, we need to get young scientists back into the academy and make it what it was in the beginning, the first thing I did is I talked to the deans of students at Columbia and NYU universities. And I said, you know, you guys don't give career advice to your students, and they need it, and you know that. And none of the schools or academic medical centers do. And if you all did what you should do, you'd all be doing the same kinds of programs like this one in the same city. So why not let the Academy, the New York Academy, run events every month of this kind? And then you get a bonus because all the young scientists of New York would come and meet each other at our academy, and they would learn things from each other. And you would also be able to say to other young undergraduates that you want to come to your university or medical center, don't go to Harvard or UCSF or Stanford or Johns Hopkins, because you could come to Mount Sinai or Sloan Kettering Medical Center or Columbia or NYU, and you would be able to network with all the young scientists of New York. So today, as an example, our wonderful Dr. Monica Kerr, who is over there, who's going to come up next, is running this program where literally thousands of young scientists come from our universities, even from Yale, which means an hour and a half train ride into New York, for then a few hours of networking and career advice, and then going home back to New Haven. And they mingle with each other, and it's the only city in the world that's like this. And so just to jump to one point about Russia, I am trying very hard to encourage Moscow and the city government to be able to do this. And you have the opportunity to leapfrog many other cities, if not almost all cities, because of the Skolkovo Foundation and the creation of the Skolkovo Open University. And the reason I say this is, if you go today to Beijing in China, the two best universities, you probably know what they are, Tsinghua and Beida. They will never work with each other. If you go to Shanghai, the two best universities are Fudan and the Jiaotang. They will never work with each other. This is the problem of most places in the world. The universities all think that the only way they can be best is to get money for themselves, and they don't work together. And we want to stop that. So that's one of the things that the Science Alliance does of the New York Academy of Sciences, and it's also what we stand for. So just to complete this little quick point about the Academy, if you're interested in the Academy, you'll discover that this idea of bringing people together to be able to help them attack the great problems of the world is so powerful now with our huge challenges in healthcare, in energy, in climate, in poverty. We find that basically these problems won't be solved by our institutions living in their own little isolated homes. They have to come together. And so one of the things that we're doing that's quite new is making global alliances where we're the neutral party that leads them of industry and academia to solve these big problems. For example, smart cities, which you may be familiar with, the idea of using the ICT, the information and communications technologies, to address everything from electronic health delivery, electronic education, security, better transportation, and better, more efficient use of energy, and so forth. We're bringing, let's say, as an example, and this is true, IBM and Cisco and Philips and General Electric and Hitachi from Japan, Ericsson and Verizon. These are companies that never worked together. Because of us, they are all coming together to work together pre-competitively with the best university experts in order to give solutions to city leaders around the world. And we're doing the same kinds of things in other areas like Alzheimer's disease, which is a very, very tough challenge right now, or in nutrition, where we have literally 2 billion people on this planet who are either undernourished and suffering from this, or they're overnourished and getting obesity and diabetes in the most amazing increases anybody's ever seen. Disastrous situation. And so we bring people together. That's what we do. And so finally, just so that you can get your program going, because you have a great program, I want to tell you that relative to Russia, we hope to be able to do these kinds of things with Russia, because as you know very well, better than we do, Russia has been isolated in many ways for too long. And you're the first, and I would say pioneering group, your age group, that are going to be the ambassadors of Russia to the rest of the world, to be involved in big global challenge programs, whether you're staying here or whether you're going out and then coming back. And so we're very proud to be able to work with you and try to see the change that has to happen here in Russia. One example will be, and if anybody's interested, I just have one of these programs. Next June, we're going to do a world-class program in science on nanotechnologies in cancer diagnosis, therapy, and prevention. The use of nanomaterials for cancer purposes, for cancer diagnosis, very, very leading edge, as we say, very frontier area. And we're going to do it with the greatest scientists of the world coming here, like Dr. Bob Langer from MIT, who's probably one of the best and is funded by RusNano, your own RusNano, and Konstantin Severinov. If you've ever heard of him, he's one of Russia's greatest nanoscientists. Right now, he's working largely in a combination of Rutgers University in New Jersey and also here, and has companies that he's started, and a world-class group of people like that. And these are the kinds of things we'd like to do. Plus, we would like to encourage the city government, and I met with the Mayor Sobyanin's lead team, Dr. Sharonov, and his group to talk about how we could help Moscow maybe create a huge group of opportunities like this one on a regular basis, so that all of you young people would learn what's going on in the rest of the world, would meet people from the rest of the world, would have opportunities to come out to the US or other places and come back. So that's what we're hoping to do in Russia. It's very nice, therefore, to start right here with you. So with that, I'm going to now introduce Dr. Monica Kerr. And I want to just mention two things about Monica and myself. I think we're kind of living role models in one way, not because we're good people, maybe you'll be better than us, but because we didn't stay in the kind of career track that anybody would have predicted. If you look at my life, I'm a very weird person, because I began as an English literature major at UC Berkeley in the crazy years when we were all having revolts and rebellions and didn't want to go to Vietnam. And by accident, really by accident, I started being a what's called a copy editor or a proofreader at an engineering magazine. And then I became a science journalist, won these prizes. And my whole career, everybody thinks I'm a PhD scientist, and I had no science at all. And it's kind of unusual to become editor of Science Magazine and then president of the New York Academy of Sciences and never have been heading any science. So what does this tell me? It tells me that if you follow your passions, you work hard, and you network well, and you're smart, you can do anything imaginable. And the reverse that it tells me, which I experienced in my own life, for example, when I was at Newsweek, is that many people, and Newsweek was a great example. Newsweek had nothing but brilliant young people. They had the most brilliant people you ever saw. As journalists, they were at the very top level. But two-thirds of them were young journalists that came to Newsweek when they were young, and they stayed at Newsweek for 15 years and 20 years, and they were frightened to go anywhere else, because no matter how great they were afraid that they couldn't succeed in another place, because they had only been at Newsweek. And then the other third came into Newsweek, and they did a great job, and then they went to other places and did great things, like me. And the ones that took the risk to come in and leave, they're the ones that were the most happy. And the ones that stayed in their little jobs and got lots of money and felt very happy, powerful, they were sad because they had no experience in the world except that one job. So Dr. Monica Kerr, she's an example because she was a cell and molecular biologist at Harvard. I think you know that university. And so shouldn't she, since she was at Harvard, just stay there and win a Nobel Prize? But she decided no, she didn't think that she was going to win probably a Nobel Prize as a researcher, even though she liked research. And she wanted to devote herself to something that was more meaningful to her. And she got interested in the issues that you face, which is young scientists, and what can they do with their lives, and nobody was telling anybody in her experience what they should and could do. So she shifted and started at Harvard to be able to be an advisor to the young people there. And luckily, we have got her at the Academy running the Science Alliance. So she's the person that put together this program. And I think you're going to enjoy meeting Dr. Monica Kerr. Thank you. Спасибо.
Well, thank you for that introduction. It's an honor and an absolute pleasure to be invited to Moscow to work with Russia's best and brightest young scientists and postgraduate students. So as Ellis already introduced, I am the director of the Science Alliance program, which has dedicated itself to career and professional development issues of PhD scientists, as well as other types of scientists, life scientists, physical scientists, engineers, who are trying to figure out what to do with their career and are in great need of the kind of mentoring that we provide. I'm also a PhD trained scientist myself, and so I'm an embodiment of the kind of things that we're going to be learning about in the next 2 days, of struggling to try to figure out what you want to do with your career, whether you decide to stay in science and become a researcher in academia or in industry, or if you're deciding to transition into a non-academic position. And so I can definitely relate and empathize to the kind of issues that you're facing here in the room and thinking about what to do with your career. And as Ellis already mentioned, I've become very interested in these issues and in trying to develop programs that will help you and educate you and inform you to make you very prepared and equipped for the future. So what I want to do is to just go through the agenda for the next 2 days, just to give you an overview of what we're going to be bringing to you. So what we've decided to do is to give you kind of a snapshot in two different areas. So today is a career and professional development theme. So we're going to be focusing on areas of the career planning process, which is something that is a lifelong skill that you'll be learned, that once you learn today, you can take with you and use forever, no matter what your career is going to be. Then we'll be focusing the rest of the day on the kind of skills and experiences that you really need to equip yourself with in order to be prepared for the academic market or the non-academic job market. And then at the end of today, we'll be having a panel on the kinds of opportunities that are available to you in Russia. And there will also be a networking reception at the end of today's program. So I hope you'll stay for that. Tomorrow is going to be focused on entrepreneurship. So that's the theme for tomorrow. And I'll be going into more detail for that. So I'll be the main speaker for tomorrow's program. And I'll be explaining to them why entrepreneurship is so important and why we're spending a whole day on it. But I hope that you all be staying for that session of the program as well. And we'll be going over what is entrepreneurship, what is high-tech entrepreneurship, how do you evaluate an idea to see if it's a worthwhile opportunity to pursue, how do you actually make money off of an idea, and then the end of the day we'll complete with another panel that will be focused on opportunities in startups. And so we'll be hearing from successful entrepreneurs and hearing about the kind of resources that are available to you. Before introducing my colleagues that I'm going to be turning today over to, I do want to congratulate all of you in the room for being here today, because this kind of program is really important for your development, and I really encourage students, postgraduate students, whatever point you are in your career, to take advantage of these kind of resources when they're made available to you, because these are exclusive, unique opportunities that not everybody has the chance to experience. And so I do congratulate you for taking the time to come here and spend these next 2 days with us. So for today, I'm going to be turning it over to my colleagues, Dr. Randy Roboto and Mr. Larry Petkovic. So I've worked with Randy and Larry for quite a while now. We've worked together, so they're not at the Academy. They actually work at their own company called Human Workflows, and they've also developed PhD training programs to help prepare you for the transition. So you'll be hearing a lot today about the kinds of things that they do when they work with scientists. So I've worked with them on a course that we run called From Scientist to CSO, which really goes into depth. It's 40 hours of training in the kind of skills that we're really just going to be touching upon today. And they also work with me on a two-day career boot camp, which we offer at the Academy, that's focused on, you know, getting ready for your career and making your transition. So they're a really great team in the way that they bring together their various skill sets. So Dr. Roboto, his background is as the scientist, the PhD-trained scientist. So he has over 20 years of experience in the scientific research and biotechnology field and has successfully made a transition from academia to industry and now entrepreneur, really running his own company. He has worked at Celera. He's also worked at Molecular Applications Group, and he's also been a principal investigator at the NIH. So definitely extensive experience in science, and he can touch upon his bio a little bit more when he takes the stage. Mr. Larry Petkovic, what he brings to the program is his experience in a variety of industries, developing and teaching social communication skills. And he also has scientific and human resources and industry experience. He holds a bachelor's in chemistry and a master's from Rutgers University in environmental radiation sciences, as well as a master's from Johns Hopkins University in behavioral sciences. So both of them bring together their various skill sets as a scientist and also as a communications expert, and they've developed this unique program called the Sci-PhD Training Programs that's geared towards giving you the kind of training and experience that you need to prepare for your careers. And so today we'll be getting a nice snapshot of the kind of things that you need to be equipping yourself for the future. So I think with that, I will ask Randy to come to the stage.